For many, listening to orchestral music is about meaning and emotion, whether it be a Russian symphony that offers insight into the repression of the Cold War Soviet Union, or a French symphony that compiles sounds like a painter compiles pastels, every note mimicking that of a brushstroke, contributing a pastel to an impressionistic masterpiece. The world of music is a complicated one, with every contribution to the repertoire seeming to offer more and more variance in meaning and feeling between individuals. The challenge becomes even harder when a composer explicitly denounces a particular interpretation of their work, yet the masses engage with the music in that way to such a degree that it has become part of the piece's context and is by default associated with the work. Copland's background as a Russian immigrant to America and his tendency to compose grand, proud music got him into a sticky situation during the Cold War, as he was called before a council to be questioned regarding his potential communist affiliation, elicited by his proud music, as he was seen as a Russian sympathizer and his music as propaganda. Goretzky's Third Symphony has been associated with the Holocaust, considering his Polish origins and its 1992 recording selling more copies than any other piece in classical music history, conveniently around the time of the 50th anniversary of the Holocaust. Whether you as a listener subscribe to these ideologies or discard them, the point is that context and meaning in music is very powerful, in spite of the composer's original intentions. Today, we will be focusing on one such case, the case of Also Sprach Zarathustra by Richard Strauss. Most people may know this piece from its use in the soundtrack of the popular 1968 sci-fi film 2001, A Space Odyssey, directed by Stanley Kubrick. This piece is the shining example of a composer's disapproval being ignored and outweighed by the interpretations of the many, for better or for worse. I will explain the complicated reception of Also Sprach Zarathustra for context, and then I will move towards the piece's construction and meaning so that we can unearth the truth and meaning behind this tone poem for so many listeners. As always, thank you for joining me. My name is Spencer Roberts, and you're listening to the Music-2-Go podcast. This introduction may represent the vastness and grandeur of interstellar space to some, with the movie most likely providing this context. To others, it may represent nothing more than a cliché, an excerpt heard in way too many commercials and televised scenarios. To scholars, however, this introduction holds a more serious, philosophical meaning. A philosopher by the name of Friedrich Nietzsche, born 1844, died in 1900, is most widely known for his poetic work by the name of the same title, Also Sprach Zarathustra. To really understand how Strauss's work is tied to Nietzsche's work, we must first understand the philosophical views and assertions of Nietzsche. A German philosopher of the 19th century, Friedrich Nietzsche was seen as a radical, as his views about human morality and life were deemed to be too aggressive and different to be widely accepted at the time. He believed that, as argued by scholar Peter Wolff, human progress includes the scouring action of downward motion as an essential ingredient. Humanity at large must fall before they can rise. Modern man is not a perfect being, the end product of an evolutionary scheme or divine fiat. He is only an ephemeral, although vital, stage in a teleological plan. Nietzsche's goal was evident. He must fill the abyss of created by the destruction of the slave morality with cogent secular life and lead man from the dangers of nihilism to a state where he is most worthy of his potentialities, as also argued by Wolff. Nietzsche saw himself as something of a prophet, as he believed that he had a duty to lead mankind to its enlightenment through his philosophical teachings. In the eyes of Nietzsche, mankind in the 19th century was slave to religion, and a change needed to be made towards living in the moment and living with a moral code that abides to oneself rather than a collective. Nietzsche's also Sprach Zarathustra features the character of Zarathustra, who in many ways paralleled himself as a metaphorical manifestation of his philosophies. Zarathustra is Nietzsche's hero, a symbolic heroine for the forces of self-improvement and enlightenment through a transcendental and, in many ways, selfish lens. At a time when the church still held much power over the state in Europe, it is very easy to see how this secular, individualistic view of life and morality could have been branded as overly aggressive and, in some cases, insane. These ideas were taboo to those who knew about them, yet they were understood, and Strauss was well aware of the philosophical portrayal and was well versed in its meaning and purpose. This work, as we will see, is clearly a tone poem based off of the principles of Nietzsche, and was so modern and forward-thinking at the time of its creation that its reception was mixed. Among those in favor of the work, none other than Strauss himself praised the many performances that he conducted across Europe. The first performance in Cologne received, as argued by scholar John Williamson, more calls from the audience than soloists, and Strauss considered one performance in Berlin in October of 1898 to be the finest performance of Zarathustra which he had experienced. Audiences seemed to feel strongly about the work, as the power of the orchestration and the philosophical ideology, though denounced by Strauss directly and taboo in society, had enraptured audiences early on. However, by the time it made its way to Vienna on the 21st of March, 1897, a music critic by the name of Hanslick had a very different opinion of the work. Hanslick's review criticized Strauss's work for being too programmatic, while simultaneously suffering criticism for not being programmatic enough. Its programmatic connection to the philosophical ideas of Nietzsche was the equivalent of a mere reillustration of those ideas in the eyes of Hanslick and many other critics at the time, while on the other hand, it was accused of not being understandable to the average audience without the program, as the ideas of Nietzsche were not widely known, and the work could not stand alone without the program handy to guide the listener. This proved problematic for the work over time, as the frequency of performances began to recede, yet the work has still endured, and those who were fans remained loyal through all of the forceful criticism from Vienna. Though Strauss tried to denounce any connection to Nietzsche for the sake of separating his work from the category of politics in music, the connections to Nietzsche in this tone poem are all too strong to overlook. Not only does the work of Strauss and Nietzsche share the same title, But the simple fact that Strauss publicly took the liberty of denouncing any correlation between his music and the philosopher or his preaching before the piece was even premiered proves that he was cognizant of potential connections being made on a large scale. Hahn, a close friend of Strauss, published the ideas of Strauss regarding this topic of connection. This work is seen as a publicity stunt, however, a statement that was employed to help avoid criticism of his composition through the lens of a composer engaging in a sort of philosophical recreation. This is all coming after the failure of his opera Guntram at its Munich premiere, and he did not want a repeat of that event. Strauss had been experiencing a decline in musical quality at the time, at least in the eyes of many critics. As quoted by the scholar David Ewan, "The tragedy is not that a genius is composing inconsequential music. Rather, the tragedy is that Strauss, a genius, has instead walked from his failures calmly, deliberately, leisurely, straight unto the gutter." Ewan uses this text to assert that Strauss's early career was his most successful period, in which his genius flourished, and after his genius was believed by society, he proceeded to unintentionally pen poor music for the rest of his career, marking a steady decline that lasted almost 20 years. Consequently, in the case of Strauss, then, Ewan also states that we have had a carefully, almost painstakingly developed deterioration, one that highlights the exploits, the petty ideals, the savage battles of the hero, that inspired Strauss to write mere musical verbosity, in which there is nothing more than a shameless padding of inane musical ideas. The German audiences at the time tended to be more curious about these potential philosophical connections between art and philosophy. And this was not a desirable connection for Strauss, as it was not good for business. There is also evidence presented through the structure of Strauss's tone poem that connects Nietzsche's hero to the depiction created within the symphonic work. Though there are debates about the most appropriate approach to analyzing Strauss's work, with each offering almost equal degrees of cohesion and validity, the most popular approach goes against the teachings of music theorist Heinrich Schenker, who has left a huge impact on the practices of music analysis through the modern day. Schenker puts the fundamental structure of the work, or the ersatz, at the center of the analysis. As stated by Williamson, taking the polarity of tonic and dominant as the central principle of an organic view of musical form and process. In Zarathustra, the two tonal centers of C and B are not seen as the center point of functional harmony. In fact, this theory does not see there to be any functional relationship between these two tonal centers outside of their use as leitmotifs to depict events that parallel Nietzsche's work. This is heavily significant, as the use of motivic content is fundamental in both Strauss's and Nietzsche's work, and therefore adds another layer of connective tissue. The ambiguity of form adds to the impact of the music. Though Nietzsche opted for prosaic work, the artistic liberty with which the ideas were set was a modern form of idea at the time and served as a source of questioning and thought provocation as both mediums attempted to express a philosophy that was already a part of the avant-garde. Revisiting the opening, both tonal centers are present, with C being slightly more dominant.
Thank you.
Zarathustra's Going Down to Become Human Again from the Philosophy of Nietzsche is believed to be incorporated by Strauss at the very beginning of the opening, indicated by the trumpet arpeggiation of a C major triad. This is seen as a narration of the sunrise, as is quoted from this section of Nietzsche's prose. Great star, what would your happiness be if you had not those for your shine? You have come up here to my cave for 10 years. You would have grown weary of your light and of this journey, without me, my eagle, and my serpent. But we waited for you every morning, took from you your superfluity, and blessed you for it. The sunrise here is a metaphor for the ascension of Zarathustra, elevating to a higher plane beyond that of man. The grandiose opening gesture of Strauss's tone poem illustrates this very well, as it is one of the most famous excerpts of the work. The opening scene of the sunrise in 2001, A Space Odyssey, offers good context to the idea as well, as you can visualize the sun rising from the horizon with the trumpet accompaniment. This parallel can easily be drawn as a reasonable narration of Nietzsche's preaching, making this a programmatic piece of music, despite Strauss's own remarks against any parallel of the sort. Here we have explicit evidence of a decisive connection, and therefore more insight into the meaning and inspiration behind the tone poem. The closing portion, however, as if to offer balance, is dominated by the tonal center of B. This proves that neither key area is more important than the other, dictating that we must look deeper into the piece for more clues to its construction outside of traditional harmony. At a more direct level, there is a correlation between the headings used to describe sections within Strauss's tone poem and sections within Nietzsche's poetic work. There is evidence of all 8 headings used in Strauss's Also Sprach Zarathustra corresponding directly to sections within Nietzsche's poetic work. As presented by Williamson, these are the headings, with their English translations, in order of their appearance in Strauss's tone poem that share common ground with Nietzsche. Von den Hinterwelten, of the Afterworldsmen, Bar 22, Part 1. Von der großen Sehnsucht, of the Great Longing, Bar 75, Part 3. Von den Freuden und Leidenschaften, of Joys and Passions, Bar 115, Part 1. Das Grablied, the Funeral Song, Bar 164, Part 2. Von der Wissenschaft, of Science, Bar 201, Part 4. Der Grinne Sunday, The Convalescent, Bar 287, Part 3. Das Tanzlied, The Dance Song, Bar 409, Part 2. Nachtwanderlied, The Night Wanderer's Song, Bar 867, Part 4. The opening of the piece is generally accepted to be identical to the opening of the book, as the same words are printed as a prologue to the tone poem as are at the start of the Nietzsche. After that, Nietzsche's sequence for the titles is completely discarded. In the words of Williamson, each part of the book apparently contributes two headings, but there is no pattern to the way in which they are placed. The complete opening remarks read as follows. When Zarathustra was 30 years old, he left his home and the lake of his home and went into the mountains. Here he had the enjoyment of his spirit and his solitude, and he did not weary of it for 10 years. But at last his heart turned, and one morning he rose with the dawn, stepped before the sun, and spoke to it thus. Great star, what would your happiness be if you had not those for whom you shine? You have come up here to my cave for 10 years. You would have grown weary of your light and of this journey without me, my eagle, and my serpent. But we waited for you every morning, took from you your superfluity, and blessed you for it. Behold, I am weary of my wisdom, like a bee that has gathered too much honey. I need hands outstretched to take it. I should like to give it away and distribute it, until the wise among men have again become happy in their folly, and the poor happy in their wealth. To that end, I must descend into the depths, as you do at evening, when you go behind the sea and bring light to the underworld too, superabundant star. Like you, I must go down, as men, to whom I want to descend, call it. So bless me then, tranquil eye, that can behold without envy even an excessive happiness. Bless the cup that wants to overflow, that the waters may flow golden from him and bear the reflection of your joy over all the world. Behold, this cup wants to be empty again, and Zarathustra wants to be man again. Thus began Zarathustra's downgoing. As I mentioned before, the opening trumpet arpeggiation of a C major triad is employed to depict the sunrise within this passage, before Zarathustra's down-going. This offers even more connective tissue that cannot be denied between Strauss and Nietzsche. With eight mostly identical headings, opening remarks taken from Nietzsche's writing himself, and a shared title, it becomes obvious how closely related the two works truly are. In spite of all of this, we still must go back to our original concern. With all things considered, Strauss indeed explicitly denounced any connection between his work and Nietzsche's philosophy, and it has been documented. Does this mean that we are wrong to believe this powerful evidence? Should a composer's intentions outweigh a work's perceived meaning and purpose, or should individual context reign supreme? How do we engage with music such as Also Sprach Zarathustra so that we ensure authenticity to both the composer and the listener? Is this a task that can be properly managed for any piece of music that is created by one and interpreted by another? These are the difficult questions that we are posed with as music scholars and music lovers. Context and meaning in music is varied for every person. We must engage with this topic as we do any other, with evidence and support, and conviction to a purpose. Nietzsche's call to action was not a popular one, but it has manifested itself in many forms, affecting many people of many walks of life, as a work of poetry does by design. We too must look into this dilemma and discern things for ourselves and continue to make these connections and assertions in an effort to further uncover more meaning and context. This process is never ending, but the reward of finding something new is well worth the toil. This is the case of Also Sprach Zarathustra, a work much more controversial and pertinent than its inclusion in a Hollywood film allows. Once again, my name is Spencer Roberts, and this has been the Music-2-Go podcast. Thank you for listening.